I have a great pleasure to introduce our rock star a good family friend, Guruduth Banavar. Guru, I met Guru in the late 90s in New York, thanks to Nevenka, his lovely wife, and an equally successful professional. Guru serves currently as a chief science officer and vice president of IBM research in the USA. At the time when we met, I think Guru was the head of the IBM research. Then you move over to India. And I recall one of my trips in the States when Guru was in charge of IBM's public sector arm. In fact, if I can use my own words, Guru invented the architecture for the command center of the city of Rio. And the mayor of Rio is used to be the client of Guru a few years ago. Last year, he spoke at the Nobel Week Dialogue series in Göteborg, which is dedicated to the future of artificial intelligence. If I'm not mistaken, you guys call it cognitive computing, right? The next generation of computers. Guru speaks four languages, of which one is Macedonian. He can even differentiate slangs. He would tell you it's not correct to say che, you should say ke. Thanks to his affiliation with Nagotino. And today he will be talking about the changing the world with technology innovation. Guru, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I'm going to stand up. You know, I just have to start by saying I was overwhelmed with the last panel. It was very moving, and I think taking one of the panelists' words, I should say that I've been extremely lucky to have a woman from Macedonia as my partner in life. And you know, yesterday when I mentioned that Nevenka, my lovely wife, who happened to not be able to make it today, you know, that I took one person from Macedonia, I'm actually happy to tell you that I'm giving two girls back to Macedonia. I have my contribution right there. So, look, it's very hard to follow an act like what we just saw, but I would like to give you a little bit of a big picture view of what is happening in the world of science and in the world of business. You know, I have the honor of having one foot in the business and one foot in science in IBM. And so I have this perspective of how science not just transforms business, but transforms society. And I'd like to share that with you today. And hopefully we're gonna have 10 or 15 minutes of questions at the end. But let me start by showing you a really inspiring day I spent at Carnegie Mellon University last Thursday with my role model. President Obama. So President Obama took a day off from his extremely busy schedule to come and talk to people like me and many of my colleagues to advance the frontiers of science and technology, business and society last Thursday. And I was very impressed when he took the stage and he was part of a panel discussion just like we had just now. And he was a panelist and he shared his passion for broadly science and technology, but not just that, specifically about artificial intelligence, the topic of our talk today. And I'm also very proud to say that I represented a significant industry in the United States and in the rest of the world. And you know, what you see here is another panel that I was on, in which it's not just IBM, but we had all of the other big players working in the area of artificial intelligence, which is Google, Microsoft, Facebook, Uber, who you all know, all household names. So we were all part of another panel where we talked specifically about the impact of artificial intelligence to business and to society. So I actually think there is a really major trend that is just starting. And I hope by the end of today's talk, you will see why this is such a major trend. But in order to make the point, I want to go back 300 years and talk about what I see as revolutions, not just in science and technology, but really in society. Think about the scale of the Industrial Revolution. And actually, if you want, you can go back 500-600 years and you can think about the printing press. How did the printing press change our society? A new technology. But think about the steam engine, how it changed the supply chain and supply networks in the world. Think about how steel and electricity changed our very existence. And in the most recent big revolution, we had information and telecommunications technology, which is, think of it as the internet, which pretty much in the last 50, 60, 70 years has completely changed our lives, right? So it turns out that these cycles take about 50 to 70 years. And there's a professor, Dr. Carlota Perez, who I refer to over here, who's done her work in talking about these revolutions that are driven by technology and how it then percolates to business and to society. And what she has noted is that every 50 to 70 years is one major such revolution. And I believe that we are at the beginning of the next revolution after information and communications technology, which is internet. I think we are at the beginning of the AI revolution or the cognitive computing revolution, which I'm going to talk about a lot more. But I think we are at the very, very beginning of it, very beginning, maybe the first few years, definitely in the first decade of it. And over the next 50 to 70 years, we're going to see this blossom into a major trend that I hope my friends my young friends who are in the audience, students and young professionals, will see in their lifetimes as something of a tremendous opportunity for themselves. Just to give you a sense, how does these revolutions work? You can see even in the last revolution, which was about 60 to 70 years, the GDP of the world pretty much increased by 100-fold. And at the same time, what was going on in the revolution in the information communication technology, we have this thing called the Moore's Law, which doubles the power of computing every 12 to 18 months. And that was on another curve. The amount of processing you can buy, which was the driver of the last revolution, was also on a similar curve. And this kind of change is not something that happens just because of chance. It's because of a concerted effort by an entire industry to change the way everything is thought about. So it's not only business, as I said. Think about how these kinds of revolutions change our society. And here I have a 200-year view of how these revolutions have changed our very economy. So in this case, you know, I tried to plot how agriculture, manufacturing, and services has changed in the world. Now look at the United States at the top left, and you'll see over the last 200 years, this is about 1800 to about 2000, agriculture used to be 80% of the American economy 200 years ago. Today, it's 3%. And what has changed maybe about 50, 100 years ago was that manufacturing was 30, 40% of the GDP and the workforce. But today, what's going on is that services has become 80, 90% of the major economies that you see on the left-hand side. And even the emerging economies that you see on the right-hand side, which are much slower to catch up. But think about India, which is where I'm from. I spent half my life in India. And I see the revolution in not just manufacturing, which is happening, but I think the revolution in services, which is accelerating and is on an exponential curve in the last 10 years or so. And I was part of it when I went to India in 2005 to be the director of the research lab there. We had, 10,000 or so professionals there, but now we have maybe 100,000. So that's a tremendous workforce increase. And a lesson that I see in the Indian picture for the last 200 years is that manufacturing is not necessarily the right thing for every economy. In India, we have a tremendous human resource available. And of course, manufacturing requires a tremendous amount of capital, which we don't always have. And so the question we ask ourselves in India is, how do we take advantage of the human resources and improve the services economy? And that has been the driver for us. So there may be something there that we come back and talk about how Macedonia is evolving. And if you look at the last 200 years and maybe project out to the next 50 years or so, how would you like it to evolve based upon the resources you have, the human resources, the economic resources, the natural resources? How would you like it to evolve? So that's one of the questions that's in the back of my mind as I talk about this next revolution. So I would like to say, what is the next big thing? What is the driver behind this next big thing that we are all thinking about? You hear about this all the time. Big data. We are generating data from everywhere and everything. In fact, we are generating numbers that are unheard of, 2.5 exabytes. Exabyte is 10 to the power 18 bytes. And that's every single day. And if I look at the amount of data that we've created right now in the world, 90% of it was generated in the last 2 years, which means the rate at which we are generating data is increasing dramatically. And this is not only the raw data that comes from, vehicles and comes from social media and comes from, your electrical grid. But it's also the amount of knowledge we are generating, the amount of scientific articles we are writing, and the amount of newspaper articles we are writing, blogs. This I think of as curated knowledge, which we have, obviously spent a lot of energy deriving, but even that is increasing at an exponential rate. It's doubling every 9 years. And so this is causing a major shift in the way that we need to think about our world. Because we now have the ability to observe and to actually make a difference in the world, in the digital world. And this requires a very new way of thinking about it. But let me show you some more trends before we even get into what do we do about it. In this tsunami that we are creating of data, we are sort of in the middle of it right now. Think about the next few years. When something is growing exponentially, you don't realize how quickly it can come up on you and you are suddenly, underwater. You don't know what to do about it. So I call it a tsunami. And we need to think very hard about how to deal with this. And we are already facing, in some parts of the world, much more so than others, we're already facing a complete inundation. We are overwhelmed with data and knowledge. I think we need to do something very different. So I want to go back to the idea that these industrial revolutions happened. So in one of the revolutions, or more than one of the revolutions, we built systems or tools that helped us with our physical power. We built cranes, we built trains, we built all kinds of physical augmenters of human power. I think we're going to need cognitive enhancers in this world of data. That's what I'm going to come back to. So this is one example. I want to pick the world of healthcare. You think about, I don't know if you can read this in the back, but if you think about the amount of data we are generating in healthcare, it's 5% is coming from our genomic data. There are billions of these base pairs that we have to think about in order to understand how to provide personalized precision medicine. There's a lot of medical care data that we are generating as well. But you know what? Most of our health can be managed through our behaviors in our society. Who do we play with? Who do we work with? Who do we eat with? What do we eat? Where do we work out? How do we sit all day long? Those kinds of determinants are much more important. And there is data about it, and we can probably help you improve your life dramatically if only we were able to take advantage of it. Today, we are not able to take advantage of it. So it's kind of dark data. It's there, but we don't know how to use it. And this is not just in healthcare. It's in every industry. You think about water. You think about food. You think about pollution and the environment. Think about geology. And we talk a lot about oil and gas industry or the energy industry. Think about any one of the industries. It's not just one or the other. It's pretty much everything we do on this planet. We now have more data, but we don't know what to do with it. And we don't know how to solve the really big problems. So I think of it as a price. We're paying a price for not knowing what to do with it. We have a problem. We don't know how to teach our kids better. We don't know how to take care of our patients better. We don't know how to take care of our environment better. And it's not because there isn't data that we could do something with. It's because we don't know how to use that data and do something with it. This is the price we are paying. So I want to talk about how we can actually do something about it in the next 50 years. And we call that cognitive computing, okay? And I actually think about this as something more than AI, okay? AI is a core part of this. AI, or artificial intelligence, is a core part of it. But it's more than AI because it requires a way for machines to be able to not only learn and reason. This is not just your father's big data and analytics stuff. This is machines that learn and reason. Learn is a big deal, and I'm going to talk more about it. But machines have to know how to work with people, because I don't think machines can be autonomous. I don't think machines are going to go off and do their own thing. I think machines are going to work as partners with people. That's a big theme of my talk today. We're going to have a partnership between people and machines, and that partnership is going to help us solve the big problems. And I think of this as, you know, when we thought of search engines making a difference to information retrieval, I think of cognitive computing as making a difference to our decision-making. And decision-making is what we do every day. Whether you're a mother who's trying to decide what food to send to your children's school, or you are a doctor who's deciding what is the best treatment for my patient, or you are a lawyer thinking about what's the best argument in court. Everything we do, we can do way better than we're doing today with the amount of data and knowledge that's out in the world that we can take advantage of with machines. So what I want to do is to give you a few examples today of what has already been demonstrated and maybe open some discussion about what can be done about it in the industries that you care about. Before I go to the examples, though, I want to show you what got us started down this path. You know, AI is not a new discipline. I've been part of AI for at least 25 years. And, the field of artificial intelligence has been around for 50, 60 years. And, you know, we made small progress as a research community, but I think something changed in the last 5 years. First thing that changed was we had all of the data that you saw. We now have that we did not have before. 10 years ago, we did not have this kind of data. You saw the curve, the exponential curve. But also, we now have algorithms, software, plus hardware that we did not have before. In the last 5 to 10 years, we have actually created new kinds of systems that can help us do things that we were not able to do before. So there was one particular thing that happened 5 years ago, and I was part of it. We built a machine in IBM that could actually do something that has never been done by a machine. And that is a natural language interaction which was on par with the best people in the world. Okay, we have a game show in the US called Jeopardy, where there are questions asked about specific topics, and you have to come up with an answer within 3 seconds. It's very difficult, very tricky. Language is already very hard because it's ambiguous. There's lots of metaphors. There's very different kind of processing. It's not like processing numbers, which is old hat, right? But machines have never been good at natural language. You know, remember 20 years ago, we built a machine that could beat Garry Kasparov in chess. That was 1997. It's called Deep Blue. And I was there in that match, and I remember very vividly the kind of emotions that we went through as a research community. But 5 years ago, this is 10 times as hard as playing chess. And I want to show you behind the scenes how my team worked on this problem and how we felt when we actually achieved this milestone. It's in the history of computing. And I want to pick up from there and then show you examples of how that can be applied in many industries. So let's look at this. It's a video, so turn up the volume, please.
I remember that morning going to the lab, and I was thinking, this is it. This is the last Jeopardy game.
This is Jeopardy, the IBM challenge.
Here we go. Brad, if you're ready, make your first choice.
Let's take alternate meanings for 200, Alex.
Four-letter word for a vantage point or a belief. Brad.
What is a view?
Yes.
After the first clue of the game, which Brad won, I had just this horrible feeling at that moment that he was as good as everyone said he was, and he was just going to run the whole board on us.
Watson.
What is shoe?
You are right.
We actually took the lead. We were ahead of them, but then we started getting some questions wrong.
Watson?
What is leg?
No, I'm sorry, I can't accept that.
What is 1920s?
No.
What is cheek?
No, sorry. Brad?
What is class?
Class, you got it. Watson?
What is Zoran?
Zoran is right, and that puts you into a tie for the lead with Brad.
The Double Jeopardy round of the first game, I thought was phenomenal.
Watson went on a tear.
Watson?
Who is Franz Liszt?
You are right.
What is violin?
Good.
Who is the church lady?
Yes. Watson.
What is narcolepsy?
You are right. And with that, you move to $36,681.
The risk was, if Ken gets a daily double, bets big, gets it right, he's going to be well ahead. And then with that kind of lead going to Final Jeopardy, if he bets enough, he could end up winning the match.
Ken.
What's a committee?
We gotta find that last daily double. We gotta find that last daily double.
It was a crucial moment in the game. There was still a daily double on the board, and it was starting to become pretty clear that it was in the legal ease category.
Let's go to legal ease for 1,200.
Watson.
What is executor?
Right.
Same category, 1,600.
Answer, daily double.
That was the moment when I knew it's over.
The category is 19th century novelists.
What Watson wants to do then is preserve the lead, not take a big risk, especially with Final Jeopardy, because just like for humans, Final Jeopardy is hard for Watson.
Now we come to Watson, who is Bram Stoker and the wager. Hello, 17,973 and a 2-day total of 77,147.
I would have thought that technology like this was years away, but it's here now. I have the bruised ego to prove it.
My past Jeopardy experiences have been great, but they weren't really weighty with this kind of technological, philosophical importance. I think we saw something important today.
Did
didn't really think very much about the implications until later and say, wow, wait a second, this is history.
Of course, this whole project is not ultimately about playing Jeopardy. It's about doing research and deep analytics and a natural language understanding.
This is about taking the technology and applying it to solve problems people really care about.
We're just so excited about all the things we can do with this.
I had thought this is the end. We get there, we're done. And I'm realizing it's just the beginning.
So this event actually woke up the entire industry. It actually was one event that woke up the entire industry. And everybody kind of said, oh my God, it's now possible to do this? That means we need to think about our business differently. Think about how many questions a doctor has to answer in order to come up with the right treatment. Think about how many questions a financial advisor or an oil acquisition expert or a lawyer or a teacher has to answer in order to get through their daily profession. And that's precisely what we are all overwhelmed with, and that's precisely what the machine is good at. Now, this is not, again, I say, this is not your dad's data analytics. In other words, this is not a time series. For those of you who are geeks in the audience, we can get geeky if you like. So this is not time series data, or it is not a statistical model that you build. It is a knowledge representation, or it is a model of the world that is not only accurate, but it's not actually accurate in the traditional sense of true or false. It's probabilistic, but even more importantly, it's constantly evolving. So it's not deterministic, meaning traditional computing, you always knew the output if you gave the same input 2 times or 1,000 times or 1,000,000 times, you got the same output. In these machines, you don't get the same output because the model is constantly evolving and the machine is learning. And when the machine learns more, it can give you a different answer tomorrow than it gave yesterday. And that is a very different way of thinking about not just the systems, but believe me when I say this, the mathematics. So we do not have the mathematics today to deal with this kind of system. We depend on logic, which was invented 100 years ago. And today, we have to combine techniques from statistics and techniques from logic and come up with a new kind of mathematics, probabilistic logics, which I think will take another 5 or 10 years. And we have a department of mathematics which is working on inventing the new mathematics for this. And then to go into the algorithms, neural networks is a very popular thing and everybody can do it now. You can do a neural network deep learning system in 3 months, maybe even in 3 weeks. But that is only good for certain sets of things, not for the broad problems that we're trying to solve. So let me come back to the business here, right? The business here is that you want your professionals, whether it's a CEO or it is the operations manager or the financial acquisition manager, you want them to have a tool that could reliably give them the best options available given not just the data in front of them, but all of the documents and all of the knowledge that has been captured in journals, in newspapers, in blogs, in your internal company documents. So it's pretty much replicating some part of what we do in our brains, but it's not everything. So it's the part of our brain that we use for managing huge amounts of data. And we want a machine to augment that part of our brain. But there's other parts of our brain which is great at the things that we heard about in the last panel, like empathy, or values, value judgments. How do I decide when two equal options exist, how do I decide which one is better based upon my society and my legal system, my personal values? Those are things that we are good at uniquely. And then there's this thing that we cannot define called common sense, which is everything that we don't know and we haven't written down, right? And we don't, you know, we can't really necessarily teach somebody common sense. It's just there. Those are the kinds of things that people are great at. And when you combine those strengths of people with the strengths of machines, when they can do statistical processing, when they can do large-scale pattern recognition and so forth, that's when you can actually change every profession and by extension, every industry. And in order to do that, I want to show you, as I said before, I want to show you a few examples. And, you know, I work in all of these industries. You know, there is oil and gas, because we talked about that, and I will come back to that. But financial services, transportation, medicine, which is one of our key first industries that we've gone into, even things like design, manufacturing, engineering. So you name the industry, and I will tell you how cognitive computing is going to change your industry. And in order to show you a few examples, I won't have time to go through all of these industries, but I decided to pick four examples to give you a sense of how industries will change. So let's take something very simple first. Think about the retail industry. You know, today you would go to a store and browse and find things, or you'd go to Amazon and do keyword search. And that's all fine, I think you need that, but you don't have the experience that you have at the store when you're going to the web through an Amazon front end. But what if you had something like this instead?
I go to the North Face website, and instead of using keyword searches, radio buttons, and drop-down menus, I ask my question the same way I would ask a manager at the North Face's physical store. I ask, I'm gearing up for a 14-day backpacking trip. What equipment do I need? Watson is able to understand my question, including a colloquial phrase such as gearing up, and it reads through the millions of pages of product information, blog posts, and relevant trade and consumer magazines to find the gear that matches my requirements. I'm presented with a rich and engaging visual experience that highlights the exact gear important for a multi-day backpacking trip. I know I definitely need a pack, so I want to know more about technical packs. I ask, can you show me technical packs? As the types of backpacks are displayed, I realize that I don't know the difference between the categories and start to feel overwhelmed. Normally, this is where I would abandon the process and either head to a store to talk to someone more knowledgeable or resolve myself to hours of online research. But instead, I turn to Watson and simply ask a very specific, personalized question. What technical pack is needed for an expedition to Fitzroy, Patagonia in the winter? By asking the question as I did, I bypassed the broader categories altogether and focused on the needs of my exact trip. Watson must correlate a large number of factors, such as the location of Fitzroy, Patagonia, and its average winter temperature at the base and at the peaks. If I were curious, I could click on the evidence button to see the information Watson used to pull its recommendation together. I noticed something about the technology Watson suggested, called ABS, that I wanted to know more about. So I ask, can you tell me more about ABS technology? Here, Watson understands the context of my question. If I had used traditional search, I would have had tens of millions of hits, most of which focused on anti-lock brakes. Instead, Watson tells me about the avalanche airbag system.
So that's the simple one, and you know, we have now put out all of the components of Watson as APIs on the cloud, and there are many startups that are now building applications like this for their own stores. So you can do that today, and it's actually a very low barrier to entry. You can start for free, and until you prove your point and get to a certain level of usage, that's when you start paying for an API call. Instead of having to buy a very large solution with consulting and everything else, you can actually get started right away with very low touch. So you can do things like this, and there are literally thousands, actually tens of thousands of developers who are building this now on a cloud-based AI platform that's called Watson. Watson is not just one machine, it's now available as a cloud. But I wanted to go a little further than these kinds of initial applications. I want to show you what's possible in the future. And this is stuff that we do in the lab, just to say what is really coming down the road in 5-10 years and how it's going to transform all the industries. And I, as I said, the other three examples I picked are not just based upon, you know, your web browser, like you just saw, but instead, you know, something a lot more complicated, but also using a tablet or a mobile phone in situ, or using robots, or using, you know, imagine an intelligent room which has Watson embedded in the walls and is helping you do your work. Maybe when you're in the boardroom, your boardroom has a Watson that's embedded that's helping you make really complicated decisions for your business. So I'm going to show you a couple of those examples. Let's look at medicine, which is going way beyond just question answering as the first step.
What you see here are a number of hypothetical medical cases that are similar to those used in the U.S. medical licensing exam. I'm going to choose one. This case shows WatsonPath's reasoning process across a deep breadth of findings, symptoms, and possible hypotheses. You can already see how different this tool, WatsonPath's, is from the system that competed on Jeopardy. These are not short, specific questions. They're lengthy scenarios that will help a physician or student learn critical reasoning skills. By pressing the solution button, I see and can interact with a visualization of WatsonPath's reasoning process. In the background, Watson searches through millions of pieces of information, medical texts, journal articles, and more. More importantly, WatsonPath asks and answers hundreds of questions about the scenario, combining the answers into complex results that we can study and evaluate. You can see the results in this solution graph. The vertical bars represent the hypotheses that WatsonPath finds most viable. The height and color of the bars indicate the level of evidence that supported the options. This is a big step on the way to presenting to the physician or student possible diagnoses. If you're a doctor, you want to learn these critical reasoning steps, so when WatsonPath shows its work, you learn what evidence supported the options presented. What you're seeing here are all of the relationships that WatsonPath found between this protein and other factors that it deemed significant to this case. And here you can see one of WatsonPath's most likely diagnoses for this case. In this instance, WatsonPath has high confidence, meaning it found lots of supporting evidence, that microalbuminuria can be a likely diagnosis. But, as I said, this is a tool for learning and teaching. Let's say the student in this instance wants to find out more about the relationship between hypotheses, represented by the curved horizontal line. The student selects the path between the two, and WatsonPath provides a result. The student can then press the Show Evidence button to review all of the evidence WatsonPath has collected in reaching this result. After reviewing the evidence, the student decides whether he or she disagrees with WatsonPath's assessment, and can press either the Agree or Disagree button. WatsonPath adds the student's opinion to the mountain of evidence it has already collected and analyzed, and automatically reevaluates the scenario, potentially arriving at new conclusions.
So the evidence part of this is particularly important because by law, doctors are required to have the full reasoning behind why they chose a particular treatment because they're liable for the results. So this is not, again, you know, just building predictive models, it's about reasoning through textual documents that can come from large populations of patients, as well as large repositories of documents like PubMed or Medline, which is very complicated and very professionally demanding for somebody to study. If you go to your doctor today, they're probably 10 years out of date with the latest research and the latest clinical trials, and they're probably giving you medicines and treatment options that were just based on their experience, which is quite narrow, and probably not taking into account the new drugs or the new treatment options and clinical trials that have probably been proven right last week. But Watson, as an assistant on a handheld, might give them that option to do so. Let me go to the financial services industry, where I'm going to show you a kind of a demo, which is a robot assistant that is providing some kind of a consultation for a person who might walk into a, you know, a kiosk or a retail kind of a place. Now, this is Again, this is a demonstration. This is not a commercial product, but I just want to show you this. And notice also that our CEO, Ginny Rometty, who I was just talking to earlier today, is also presenting to a large audience like this. Check this out.
I want to help give customers the best possible experience. I'm also learning the language of various industries. To work in a bank, for example, I have to become an expert in banking systems. For instance, there are three main types of mortgages: fixed rate, adjustable rate, and interest-only mortgages.
Okay, so what should I consider for an interest-only mortgage?
Because your monthly payment would only repay the interest accruing on your mortgage. The only equity you would have on your home would be the amount you paid for a down payment.
That's helpful.
But wait, there's more. You would not build equity unless the market value of your home were to go up. If the market value of your home were to decline, then you could lose part or all of your down payment.
Oh, that sounds very serious.
I know. Bummer.
Well, you know, this is just a prototype that we're building, which is also trying to incorporate elements of, you know, an emotional interaction, which at least you want to be able to naturally understand a person's state of mind, you know, whether somebody's frustrated when they're asking a question versus when they are pleased with the answer, so you can improve customer satisfaction. But I think the thing I want you to note here is that this requires domain expertise. This is not just understanding language at the level of, let's say, you know, a kindergartner or a primary school student, but it's learning it at the level of a professional who is able to have a more sophisticated but also a productive conversation with a customer. The last scenario that I want to show you, and then I want to sort of zoom back again and see how this is going to impact us as a society, is the scenario of a boardroom. So many of you are CXOs and you spend a lot of your time in boardrooms, and you constantly are faced with making very complex decisions. For example, it could be a decision about acquiring a company. It could be a decision about acquiring an oil field, but it's an acquisition decision. And that usually requires a level of judgment, which only comes from people, but it also requires a tremendous amount of knowledge and data that comes from many different sources, which can actually lead you down the wrong path if you're not careful about it. So if you had a Watson in the boardroom as another participant in a collaborative discussion, and Watson is able to recognize biases, recognize where you need more information, and provide you and steer you in the direction that you want to go in, we think of that as a net gain. And we see many scenarios where that is actually happening. I'll show you one.
Watson, show me companies with revenue between $25 million and $60 million pertaining to analytics.
Let's see what I can find. I found 87 companies.
Nice.
Okay, so that's a good start. What
that's
do you think, Brian?
But I was doing some homework, actually. I think we should pull in that Watson Strategy Group document. There's a lot of key concepts in there. Let's feed it to Watson.
All right. Watson, please regard this as cognitive strategy.
Watson, show me companies with revenue between $15 million and $60 million pertaining to cognitive strategy.
Let's see what I can find.
Yeah, this is nice.
I found 112 companies.
Now we're getting a lot in here. And we can see we're getting some connections too, I think.
Watson, show me companies that are about analytics and cognitive strategy that are most similar to the companies named Wolfram Alpha and Kawasaki Robotics.
I found three companies similar to the ones you specified.
Beautiful.
Well, let's see what we think of these.
Dive a little deeper. Let's compare these things.
Sure. Watson, show me a decision table.
Here is a decision table that will enable you to compare companies side by side.
Okay, but I think we need a little more than that. We need some other attributes. Watson, place the attributes named revenue and employees and corporate structure in the decision table.
Okay.
All right, so now we've got this side-by-side comparison. What do you think?
Yeah, I think that's right.
Watson, give me a suggestion.
I have a suggestion.
Yeah, I stopped it there because it got a little confidential, but...
Watson, show me companies with revenue between $25 million and 60...
It went back. But in that previous scenario, I would like you to notice that this kind of capability which says, show me companies that look like this, is a very, very complex question. It's actually thinking about, you know, the business strategy, it's talking about corporate structure, it's talking about financials, it's talking about organizational things, it's talking about culture. It's a very complicated question. And of course, it's a long way before we can really take all dimensions of that into account when answering a question like that. But we can already make a very significant and a good answer that can help people make decisions much faster and more effectively than what they would do without such a tool. But I hope what I've shown you in all of these four examples is that you can imagine yourself having a cognitive assistant, so to speak, on your shoulder. Think about a Watson on your shoulder or in your pocket that you can turn to and whisper every time you have a hard question. And Watson tells you, you know, whispers back, look, you know, maybe you don't want to do that. Maybe you consider these three options. And you think about them and you say, why do you think option two is better than option three? And Watson tells you, look, I found these three studies, or I found these five facts that this expert came up with, and I would like you to take that into account before you make that big decision about buying your car or sending your daughter to college or about making a big treatment decision if you're a doctor. And I can actually think of that happening in every single person's life. That's what makes me believe that we're going to have a revolution in the next 50 to 70 years. And we call that the cognitive era, where just like in the previous industrial revolutions, we were able to augment our physical strength, we are now going to be able to augment our cognitive capabilities so that we can be much better at what we do. And today we are struggling with many problems, which tomorrow hopefully we won't be struggling with those same problems. And my vision, really, is that every single professional on the planet, think about, you know, 2 billion professionals or 3 billion professionals who are all knowledge workers, and remember that services picture that I showed you earlier on, that workforce is going to have mostly knowledge workers. And those knowledge workers need this kind of a cognitive support system to help them do their jobs. And that's where I think we're going. And for those of you, again, who are geeks in the room, I want to say that this is AI, which is a very different approach than what you might know about as artificial general intelligence, or AGI, where we think of one mechanism that solves all of the problems. But instead, what I think about here is, how do I take narrow intelligence, narrow AI, and over time, bring that together to create more and more effective systems? In fact, the way I'd like to think about it, if you can indulge me a little bit here, is when you know, I have this table here where, you know, when you go through your education, you go through elementary school, middle school, high school, college, and your professional degree, and on the right-hand side, you have all of these tests and certifications and everything. So, for example, if you're an accountant, you take a certified public accountant, CPA exam. Or if you're a radiologist, you take a different professional exam. But, you know, when you join college, you can take an SAT, or when you are in elementary school or middle school, you can take a standardized test that your state or your country provides. All of those are things that we do naturally as humans, but as we go through it, what we are really doing is we are learning tasks, many different types. We have tasks for ingestion, meaning digesting knowledge, cogitation, thinking about it, creating new artifacts, interacting with other people to find things. So for example, when you're in primary school, you could learn how to read a picture and answer a question. But as you go through your college, you may be able to learn how to write papers. And when you go to become a professional, you learn how to negotiate. These are all different skills and different tasks. And I think of which of these tasks can we teach machines effectively so that they can help people do the same tasks better. So for example, if I look at a, I don't know what example I have a radiologist here. So a radiologist, I think about what are the tasks that I need to teach a radiology system in order to make a radiologist's life more productive and effective and less stressful. That's how I approach this problem. And you can think of thousands of these professions at the top, each of which has their own Watson on the shoulder that we develop. You know, think about it, you know, maybe as a personal assistant or a professional assistant, just like you would have one today in your normal profession. So that's how I'm approaching this this long-term vision. And the last thing I want to tell you, and this is the most important thing, is really that this is not about autonomous machines. This is about people and machines combined to create a system that is better than either one of them working by itself. So think about all of these scenarios. If you're doing surgery, or if you're doing some operational task, or teaching, or even space exploration, all the industries that we've thought about and talked about in the last 2 days, this is going to require human judgment and human values, and it's going to require machines that can give us the knowledge and the options necessary to come up with the right decisions when we think about it. So this is what I think my role model, Obama, sees when he decided just a few weeks ago, he was on the cover of the Wired magazine. And he has an article in there, "We must remake society in the coming age of AI." And I would actually encourage you to read and watch the video where Obama talks about how AI is indeed changing every industry. In fact, I've been working personally with the White House for the last few months to develop a number of technological capabilities and, you know, directions for investment that will, in fact, get every industry the kinds of capabilities that I believe we need. It's not just I, but every entity in the United States that works in the field of AI, whether you're academic or you are an industry person or you are a nonprofit organization, has contributed to the study, which the White House just put out as a paper about the future of AI and how we as a society and as a government should prepare for this future. You see this happening already. You know, Uber is making you know, some kind of a pilot already with self-driving cars in the city of Pittsburgh. Think about the impact of that. You're going to have definitely fewer accidents, and it's going to be safer to drive a self-driving car than a person driving a car in general. And this has been shown in several experiments, which are still in the early phase, but it has been done. But it's going to have a tremendous social impact. Jobs are probably not going to be the same, right? I mean, you want to have some high-risk types of jobs that are going to be done by people, where there's accountability and where there's probably regulation. But there are many other jobs where you want to increase safety, and that's going to probably get us in that direction. But we have to ask ourselves the question, as a society, where do we want this balance to fall? Do we want it in the middle? Do we want government to regulate? Do we want people to self-organize? Do we want something else? Do we want to not have these kinds of technologies in our lives? We have to think about this. So there are many social implications of this, and I think we are really very, very early in this conversation, and I hope that we can have this conversation even further as we go along. So thank you very much for this opportunity. It's a really, really... I just want to say, Zoran and Robert, Biljana, this is an incredible forum that you have set up. I'm really very happy to be here, actually proud to be able to participate in this and see that you care so much. I think the community cares so much about the future of the country and that you're trying to do something about it. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Guru, thank you very much. I mean, this is fascinating. I mean, what I saw reminded me on my childhood and Space Treks and Dr. Spock and yes. And all the things that we thought weren't going to happen in the centuries to come, but this is coming soon, obviously. Yeah. We've been told that we need to get out of here at 6, so we don't have much time for Q&A, but I'll just give opportunity to maybe to one or two quick questions for Guru.
Hi, my name is Misha Markovsky. I'm from Upstrand World IT Market Research Company. So basically, we have been following IBM recently. You have done acquisitions in the analytics. You have acquired Truven for patient data. You have acquired Merge Healthcare. You have acquired a couple of startup healthcare analytics. You have embedded all that in IBM Watson Health Cloud. Yes. What we can expect from that product, let's say in the next 10 or 20 years? Because I saw an application about education. But what is the practical mean of that product? What we can expect in the healthcare?
Well, I think in 10 years, you would not want to go to a doctor who does not have a Watson with them. Okay? Because you're just going to say, look, this is too risky to go to a doctor that does not have a machine that helps them, right? Because I hope that we would have demonstrated with real examples that the effectiveness of treatments with a machine like Watson would in fact be way better than without, right? But let me tell you practically what's going on today. I showed an example that was intentionally a little bit farther out, okay, because it's showing this Watson paths, which is giving you evidence and hypotheses and all of those things. But just in the last couple of months, we have announced a number of products for the healthcare industry, some of which are in the continuum of care, as in diagnostic, as well as imaging technologies that can help you both in, you know, radiology type scenarios for different situations like cardiology and oncology and so forth. So assistance for doing, you know, let's say oncology as a practice. So there is a solution available for that from the Watson Health Cloud. But on the other end of the spectrum, there are genomic solutions. For example, if you are looking for drug discovery or drug matching for a patient who is going through glioblastoma, which is brain cancer, there's a way now to get the sequenced genomes over to Watson to be able to say which mutations and which protein pathways are going to likely be affected and which off-label drugs, meaning drugs that are not necessarily yet approved for the specific condition that you're going through, but is available in the market, has been shown to impact the same protein pathways that you're suffering from. So that's a drug discovery type of a scenario. So that kind of a scenario is commercially available as of the last couple of weeks. And there's actually 6 other products which I don't have time to go through, but these are products that I encourage you to look up that are now being made available not only in the developed markets like the United States and Europe, but also in Malaysia and India and other parts of the world that are just coming up. You know, imagine a hospital in India which has access to cancer care, which is at the level of Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, which is one of the best in New York. And you can do that now because there's remote access to these kinds of systems through the cloud, and you can get the best kind of advice that was trained by Memorial Sloan Kettering. The system, the Watson system, was trained by Memorial Sloan Kettering, but it's now available in a hospital in Thailand or in India to provide the same kind of care. So this is the kind of thing that we are getting to. And I'll just say one more thing. There was a 60 Minutes television segment that came out last week that I'd encourage you to see, and it talks about specifically healthcare applications that are currently now being made commercial.
Guru, yeah. During the Industrial Revolution, people used to destroy machines because of concerns that they're going to lose their jobs.
Yes.
Is something like that possible to happen with this technology? What kind of jobs are in danger? What kind of new jobs will be created?
Good question. And, you know, this is one of the big discussion topics right now. I think with every one of those revolutions that we saw on that picture, the jobs landscape has changed. There are some jobs that have become obsolete. There are new jobs that are created. And there are some jobs that have been just redefined. So if you ask me how the future is going to look like, I think there are two major implications. One is to education, and one is to our assumptions about jobs. Okay, so let me talk about the second one first, okay? If you are doing routine knowledge jobs, where you're doing the same kind of, you know, input, same, you know, similar kinds of outputs happening every day, it's very likely that you will be asked to use a machine to do the routine part, and you do the creative part of it, which is, how would you redesign the process? How would you get to a customer relationship type of discussion, which is much more on the empathy end of the spectrum? So if you think about healthcare, you may want the doctor to spend more time with the patient face-to-face, understanding their social situation, their psychological situation, rather than going off and reading documents every day and coming up with, you know, tables and lists of things that they should be checking for, right? So the human-to-human interaction types of jobs are going to increase. The routine knowledge tasks that can be automated through learning machines will decrease. And in terms of education, I would say that everyone has to be taught how to use learning and reasoning machines from day one. I think schools should change their education curricula. And schools should not be doing rote tasks as their teaching process. Instead, they should be talking about the creative tasks, about the human tasks, and about tasks that ultimately require us to use larger, bigger picture types of considerations like values, rather than to look at, okay, if I have these three inputs, I'm going to get this output, because machines are going to be able to do that way more in the future.
Fantastic.